So welcome everyone. This is my great privilege today to introduce this new webinar series on rate splitting and rate splitting multiple access. So this is a new special interest group that was created by the IEEE in the IEEE Communication Society. And we have the privilege today to have the first speakers of this series, Professor Edward Joswick from the Technical University of Brunswick. And excuse me, Edward, for my pronunciation. Edward is a very well-known researcher and professor in our field, is currently a full professor and the head of the chair for communication systems at Brunswick. He was before, for over 10 years, full professors and chair of communication theory at Technical University of Dresden. He's been extremely active in the communication information theory and signal processing societies, where he has published extensively, received multiple awards for journal papers and for conference papers. He has also been active as an editor-in-chief of the EuroZip Journal on Wireless Communication and Networking, and was part of the editorial board of multiple IEEE journals, and is an IEEE fellow. And today we have the great privilege to hear his talk about rate splitting and resource allocation in interference networks. So before I give you the floor, Edward, let me do a little bit of housekeeping. So the talk will be 15 minutes long, and we will mute the audience to make sure that we hear everything clearly. If you have any questions, you can type it in the chat, and then we'll have 10 minutes at the end for Q&A, where you can raise your hand, and we're going to mute a few people. We're going to mute a few people to have some live discussions, and we're going to also answer questions from the chat. And with this, let's hear from Edward.
Yeah, so I hope you can see the first slide. And first of all, I would like to thank Lina and Bruno for the invitation to speak at that webinar series within the special interest group on RSMA, rate splitting multiple access. And it's also very, very kind to be the first speaker of the first season. Thank you also for the introduction. And I think we can start right away looking at the agenda for today. So since I'm the first speaker in the first series of webinars, I thought it's a reasonable idea to start with some history about rate splitting, mainly from the point of network information theory, and understand where this concept first occurred and how it was first applied, in which setup, in which channel models, and then proceed to typical questions that arise after the information theoretic basis or the fundamental limits are understood, namely how to do an efficient resource allocation and power control in the systems where rate splitting was introduced. And special attention is paid here to the cases where we have the, let's say, common coding schemes compared to rate splitting approaches. And typical questions are related to the achievable rate region, to the feasibility problem, so given quality of service requirements, is it feasible? And to a distributed implementation of these resource allocation schemes. So we will look at that. And afterwards, I would like to present some of our initial work we have done on the optimal rate splitting in interference channels by using approach which comes from microeconomic theory, which is based on market theory. And we can provide some results about the characterization of the Pareto boundary of the achievable rate region with rate splitting and its distributed implementation by some distributed algorithm, which is called after Walras. And then in the end, I would like to raise or look at some challenges which we could address in order to establish rate splitting in beyond 5G and 6G communication systems. And this will include the discussion of a simple interface to the system level that is then used to do the typical tasks on the medium access control layer, which include scheduling, rate adaptation, and of course power control. And as a second set of challenges, I would then raise some connections to modern current technologies which are considered for beyond 5G and 6G. Okay, so that's the plan. And we would like to start with the history of rate splitting and network information theory. So we start with a basic network channel model. This is, I would say, the classical channel model that you learn in network information theory class, and yeah, I also teach that in network information theory. So the classical interference channel is modeled as follows. You have two transmitters, and each of them has an independent source with source messages W1 and W2. The encoder then, you have two encoders for each transmitter one, then builds code words of length N separately, independently from each other, and it's fed into the interference channel with two inputs and two outputs. The two receivers are also non-cooperative, they do not collaborate, and they have to decode the received sequences in terms of the messages that they are interested in. So the first receiver provides an estimate of message W1 and the second of W2. And this basic setup here is a discrete memoryless interference channel. It's characterized by the channel input alphabets, the conditional joint distribution of the outputs given the inputs, and the output alphabets. And since it's a memoryless channel, we can write the joint distribution of the outputs given the inputs as a product over the channel uses from k equal to 1 to n. Interestingly, this channel model, this interference channel, has not been solved. We don't know the capacity region of this one. It probably first occurred in this setup in a paper by Rudolf Alswede in 1974. Okay, so what is the task? Like usual, yeah, we want to transmit the sources, the source data. This is basically two independent and uniformly distributed integers from the message sets over the interference channel by using a so-called discrete memoryless interference channel code with code rates R1 and R2. And this code consists of two encoding functions at the two separate encoders and two decoding functions at the two separate decoders. The problem then is to find the set of rate pairs for which there exist these interference channel codes such that the error probability approaches zero if the block length goes to infinity. And the closure of the set of rate pairs is called the capacity region of the discrete memoryless interference channel. And quite early, already in the 70s, the following limit expression is known. So this is basically the capacity region of the interference channel. Now it's the limit n block length goes to infinity closure of some union of all code words of length n at the first encoder and the second encoder, and the rates should satisfy these mutual information inequalities. Unfortunately, this characterization is not very easy, and it is hard to compute a real rate region based on that. So it is not useful to use this expression for resource allocation for power control. Now, soon after the introduction of this channel model, there are a series of works about the fundamental limits. It's very helpful to normalize the interference channel, and that means that we normalize the direct links from the transmitter to the receivers to one, and the interfering links are then denoted by coefficients A12 from transmitter 1 to receiver 2 and by A21 from transmitter 2 to receiver 1. And for different operating regions, people have looked at the capacity region. So if you cannot solve it in general, it's a good idea to deconstruct the problem in smaller pieces and then to look at what you can achieve. So if there's no interference, it's simple. We have two parallel channels. Capacity is known. Then very strong interference, this condition we will talk about on the next slide, and strong interference, in these two cases, the capacity region is also known. For moderate interference, the capacity region is not known, and unfortunately, this is the case that we usually have. For example, in cellular communication, then we will associate a user with the next nearest base station, so the direct link will be stronger than the interfering links. And that directly corresponds to the case where the interfering channel coefficients are smaller than 1. For some special cases, there is also the capacity region known, but we will not talk about these. Okay, so if you have very strong interference, that means the interference channel gain is larger than the transmit power plus 1. The idea is that the interfering signal in your received signal is strong enough that you can first decode it, and because it is so strong, it does not impose additional rate constraints with respect to the data rate of this user signal. And this is done by successive interference cancellation, and it is done without any additional costs. So, for example, user 1, the first receiver, Y1, can just decode the interference it receives from transmitter 2 because the interfering signal is so strong that the rate requirement that has to be fulfilled in order to decode it correctly is automatically fulfilled due to the rate constraint of the second channel. So from the point of view of one receiver, this corresponds to the scheme, which is also well known at that time in 75, from the broadcast channel, because this scheme is superposition coding and successive interference cancellation. It is well known that this scheme achieves the capacity region of the degraded broadcast channel. So in now this, the very same idea popped up also under the name power domain non-orthogonal multiple access, where one receiver, the stronger receiver, can decode this interfering signal before it decodes its own signal. So in this case, the capacity region is the same as if the interference is not there, because we can subtract it without any further constraints. And therefore, the paper was also titled A Case Where Interference Does Not Reduce Capacity. Now, what happens if the interference is strong enough or stronger than the main channel, the main signal, but it is not stronger than P1 plus 1? So this is the case when we have strong interference, the coefficient is larger than 1, and in this case, the very same strategy that we just talked about achieves the capacity region. Namely, each receiver performs multi-user detection, or a scheme that is called non-unique simultaneous decoding. So the first receiver decodes both signals of the transmitter 2 and transmitter 1. It is only interested in its own signal, and so it basically is not really interested in the correct decoding of the second signal. But in this case, when we have when we apply successive interference cancellation, it decodes first the signal from the interfering link, subtracts it, and then decodes its own data. So the capacity region is basically an intersection of two multiple access capacity regions, namely for the first receiver, this is a multiple access channel, And from the point of view of the second receiver, it's also a multiple access channel. So in this case, we also know the capacity region. However, this is again a scenario where the interfering links are stronger than the direct links. So what happens in the case of weak interference? If the interference is very weak, a good strategy could be to treat interference simply as noise. And that means we apply a point-to-point code, and the first receiver decodes its own data, treating the interference as noise. So we have the achievable rate region with TIN, that is R1 is smaller than log 1 plus the SINR, signal power divided by 1 plus interfering power. Interestingly, if the interference is sufficiently weak, the sum capacity of the interference channel is achieved with treating interference as noise. That was shown in this paper over here. So for very weak interference, we also know what is the sum capacity achieving scheme. However, for moderate interference, we don't know. Before we go deeper to that case, let's consider these two border cases. So for strong interference, we are decoding the interference completely and subtract it from the signal, from the received signal, before we decode our own data, compared to treating interference as noise, where we just forget about the interference and decode as good as possible. If we constrain our interference channel setup to the application of simple point-to-point codes, so each encoder is restricted to use a simple point-to-point code, then it was shown in this paper here that the capacity region is the union of the achievable rate regions with proper Gaussian codebooks, typical for point-to-point codes, where each receiver can decide to either use joint decoding, so basically performing the decoding strategy from the multiple access channel, or treating interference as noise. And you can write down the capacity region of this point-to-point restricted interference channel as the union over the choices of the decoding strategies, TIN or joint decoding, and the intersection, this is for the two receivers, the intersection of the corresponding achievable rate regions for user 1 and user 2, because both users have to successfully decode both messages. And you can see here the achievable rate region expressions for treating interference as noise and joint decoding. So treating interference as noise is easy, and joint decoding, you have the requirement for the single user decodability of the first user, plus you have the sum rate constraint that we know from the multiple access channel. So that's also an interesting result. However, one could do better in the moderate interference channel, where the idea is to create a scenario where you have a combination of both extreme cases. So you do not decode the interfering data completely, but instead you apply rate splitting. And so the first occurrence of this scheme, rate splitting, was in 1981. It's exactly 30 years ago. No, it's 40 years ago. 40 years ago, in the paper by Han and Kobayashi. Therefore, it's also called scheme Han-Kobayashi coding. And the idea is to split messages into private and common parts to create an intermediate case between treating interference as noise and successive interference cancellation. The common message is decoded by both receivers, while the private message is only decoded by the intended receiver, and it is considered as noise by the other decoder. And what is very important is that this is the largest achievable rate region, or let me say it in other words, if you restrict yourself to random coding ensembles, to rate splitting Superposition coding. Make the statement correct. If you restrict yourself to random code ensembles, then the largest achievable rate region is the region achieved with rate splitting, superposition coding, and coded time sharing. This was shown in this paper by Bandemar and others in 2015. So rate splitting is here really necessary, and we cannot achieve this region with point-to-point codes. Instead, we have to split the message. We have to do some encoding at the transmitter side, which breaks with the simple point-to-point codes. Now, how does the achievable rate region looks with rate splitting? So rate splitting, superposition coding, and coded time sharing. I will not show you the expression for coded time sharing because this gives a lot of degrees of freedom what you can do, because you cannot only take linear combinations between achievable points of the rate region. Coded time sharing means that you can optimize each individual strategy for this amount of time that you allocate for it. What I show here is the achievable rate region in the interference channel without coded time sharing in the simplified version that you can also find in chapter 6. Oh, I'm sorry for that. Chapter 6 in this book by Elgar, Mal and Kim. And what we can see here is the rate restrictions of the private messages of the two users, R11 and R22. We can see the rate splitting parameters lambda 1 and lambda 2. So lambda 1 is the amount of power that we allocate for the private message of transmitter 1. Lambda 2 is the amount of power we allocate for the private message of transmitter 2. And 1 minus lambda 1, denoted by lambda 1 bar, is the amount of power we allocate for the common message of transmitter 1. And lambda bar 2 is the amount of power we allocate for the common message of transmitter 2. The two rate inequalities here are R12 and R12 here, these two inequalities are the required constraints that we have for the decodability of the common message of user 1 at receiver 1 and at the receiver 2. Because we said that the common message should be decoded by both receivers, we have two inequalities for the common message part. The same holds for the common message of the second transmitter. We have two inequalities that we have to fulfill. By the way, in the notation here is Z of X is the Shannon capacity log 1 plus X. I already told you about the rate splitting parameters, lambda 1, this is between 0 and 1. And what is very important is that the total achievable rates for user 1 and user 2 are the sum of the private and common message for the two users. So what we get is, for user 1, the sum of this guy, R11, plus the minimum of R1 inequality on the left side and inequality on the right-hand side. And the same for the second user. So this was where rate splitting occurred first, and indeed, it was very successful because it is up to now the largest known achievable rate region for the interference channel, for the Gaussian interference channel with moderate interference. It also was invented in terms of another multi-user channel, which is the multiple access channel, in 1996 by Rimoldi and Urbanke. And this idea was applied to multiple access channels with multiple transmitters and one receiver, where they have shown that any point in the capacity region of a Gaussian multiple access channel is achievable by single user coding without requiring synchronization among users, provided that each user splits data and signal into two parts. So it's the very same idea from the Han Kobayashi coding applied to the multiple access channel, with the additional observations that we can that we only need some rough synchronization on the symbol level, and it is sufficient to have point-to-point or single-user codebooks when we apply this to two virtual sources per user, that it can be decoded and achieve the same capacity region as the typical multiple access channel coding strategy. I will not talk about this, but I will ask the following question now. Rate splitting was introduced in the interference channel 40 years ago. It is still the best achievable rate region that we have now for the moderate interference channel. Rate splitting was introduced to the multiple access channel 25 years ago in the paper by Rimoldi, 96. Why is it not applied in cellular or other mobile communication standards? It is considered for 6G. I've seen, for example, this paper here by colleagues, Bruno, Lina, and others, where rate splitting multiple access is considered to be the new frontier for the physical layer of 6G. And I tend to agree, but I see also some questions. So one possible answer to this question, why is it not yet standardized, is because the efficient resource allocation and power control is too complicated. And of course, since you are all experts in this area, you might ask, what does it mean, too complicated, and for whom? And therefore, motivated by this question, I would now like to take a look at what is so different if we try to do resource allocation and power control for a system or for an interference channel with rate splitting compared to a system without rate splitting. And this is the second part of the talk. So this is now the resource allocation power control in interference channels with and without rate splitting. Typical questions that we have are, how does the achievable rate region looks like? How can we compute it fast, efficiently? How can we solve the feasibility problem? And how can we find a distributed stable optimization in terms of power control and resource allocation? So let's take a look at the achievable rate region. You see here a simple plot. It's very simplified, like all plots in this presentation, of a two-user achievable rate region for moderate interference regime, where the first interference channel has the power, the channel gain 0.9, and the second interference channel is 0.8. And the rate, the achievable rate region with rate splitting is the green one. So basically, we achieve all points on the upper boundary of this box. Then the green curve, and then the parallel, the right side of this boundary box. So all points below the green line and the connections with the edges are achievable with rate splitting. The achievable rates with treating interference as noise, this was studied in the literature very, very early, and I just added one reference here, how to characterize the Pareto boundary of this region. In this paper over here, there you basically characterize the Pareto boundary by formulating two optimization problems for the two regimes, either left or right from this circle here, and then you can compute the Pareto boundary efficiently. By the way, this operating point 1,1 means that both users transmit with full power. Okay, now let's look at the problem of power control. So given rate requirements, how can we compute the necessary power that each user should get in order to achieve his rate requirements. And there is a large body of work on power control for interference channels. And there was one particular technique very successful, namely the Perron-Frobenius theory. This is basically a theory about matrices with positive entries. And in this case, the theory was applied to solve the power control problem in closed form. The idea is to write down the rate requirements as equations in terms of the powers and observe that you have basically a linear system of equations. Because the achievable rates, I will go back to the corresponding expression here, the achievable rates can be very well written as, you bring the logarithm to the left side, the minus one to the left side, and then basically you multiply with the lower term, and then you can see that you have an inequality which is linear in the power p1 and p2. And when you write down all these equations for the users, you get a system of linear equations. And this is described here in this equation. Gamma contains the channel gains of the diagonal channels, also of the direct channels. A is the so-called coupling matrix, which contains the entries of the interfering terms. Mu also contains part of the individual direct link fading. P is the vector with the powers, and eta contains the rate requirements. And you can see that here, in order to solve this linear system of equations, what you do is you multiply with the inverse matrix of this bracket, then you have a closed form expression for your powers. And in order to check whether this inverse exists, it is sufficient to take a look at the largest eigenvalue of this matrix over here. And then you can basically decide whether the problem is feasible or not. This is for the simplest case, where you don't take into account power constraints or any other constraints, and where this system setup is very simple. But it shows you that you have a closed form power control for this interference channel. Okay, I have only two references here. This is not by far not complete. There are many papers about that. One more recent in this Foundation in Trends and Networking, and another one with from colleagues published in Springer. The good thing is that for the distributed implementation, there are also many algorithms available. I think the most famous algorithm is by Foschini, and the idea is basically you do this SINR measurement and you update your power control according to the rate requirement or the SINR requirement. And when you do this, this distributed algorithm will converge to the optimal minimum power. But you can also apply non-cooperative game theory. This has been done for the standard Gaussian interference channel. This has been done for the two-user linear deterministic interference channel in this paper by Barry and Che. It has been also done for the extension, including multi-user detection and joint decoding for the interference channel in the third reference. And the basic idea is always that you try to characterize the non-cooperative solution. So does it exist? Is it unique? Is it Pareto optimal or not? And then you can use this non-cooperative solution in an algorithmic way to find in a distributed optimization the necessary power. This is possible for the general interference channel with treating interference as noise and with simple point-to-point codes. So you can use multi-user detection joint decoding. In general, the optimization problem that we have for this interference channel with power control has a very nice generalized expression. We maximize one function, which depends on the power allocation and the rates, over a set of inequalities. They can contain individual rates as well as sums of rates of the individual users. And on the right hand side, we see this log 1 plus SINR expression that we observe in this treating interference as noise as well as in joint decoding. So the region that I have shown you before when I talked about the capacity region of the point-to-point coded interference channel can be treated in this optimization problem. And in particular for this optimization problem, we have developed some efficient tools to find the optimal operating point that maximizes different objective functions, including weighted sum rates, weighted energy efficiencies, global energy efficiencies, but also other functions F, which can be used for network utility maximization. The requirement that this works is that we have this special form of inequalities. Okay. Now, if we want to apply these results, starting from Perron-Frobenius theory over the distributed power control to the optimization of the general rate region operating points, and we want to apply this to rate splitting, we have the following observation. In rate splitting, we have per user, K, two terms, namely the rate of the private message and the rate of the common message, which should be greater than some rate requirement. And this problem is really difficult because we have two log 1 plus something terms, which have to be greater than or equal to a rate requirement. And the SINR expressions in general are non-convex, and we have outside a sum of logarithms. And you cannot simply solve this for the required power allocation. This complicates things. If you take a look at the current literature in this area, you see that this problem is approached in many papers. For example, here in this paper published last month. But the optimization problem contains this type of inequalities, and there is no global optimal solution. You have to do some approximations. Either you go into the direction of heuristic algorithms, or you go in the direction of approximations, sequential convex approximations for these optimization problems. And also the sum rate maximization that was looked at recently for rate splitting. This is the second reference. This was the ICC paper last year. On downlink sum rate maximization for rate splitting multiple access. Okay, here it's for RSMA and the downlink, but it has to deal with the same optimization problems. Ended up in an algorithm which contains one-dimensional search method. And that is clear that it ends up in this because the sum rate maximization is difficult in the standard interference channel as well. It was shown in this reference over here that this problem is in general NP hard, and we will not find an efficient algorithm. So there is still good hope that with or without rate splitting, or so rate splitting does not put too much additional complexity into the problem. However, you can see here some results from the second reference where you have the sum rate, the cumulative distribution function of the sum rate, and there are significant gains if you compare non-orthogonal multiple access OFDMA with rate splitting multiple access. So rate splitting multiple access is really performing best. And this is for single antenna case. I'm not talking about multiple antenna cases. So therefore, we should invest some efforts in order to understand what is the optimal rate splitting in the interference channel, because we want to achieve the gains that we can get from rate splitting. And that is what we would like to look at next. So let's take a look at the rate expressions again. They depend on the rate splitting parameters lambda 1, lambda 2. And the rate of user 1 is the rate of the private message plus the rate of this common message that we have discussed before. If we know that we are in the moderate interference regime, we make sure that the signal to interference and noise ratio of the first term is always greater than or equal to the SINR of the second term. So the rate expression simplifies to the sum. However, we still have the challenge that now the rate of user 1 is the sum of two log 1 plus SINR expressions. The choice of the rate splitting parameters of user 1 influences the achievable rate of the other user and vice versa. That means we have a conflict situation and we try to model it as a market model. Okay, you will now say, okay, why do we have to take the detour over the market model? The reason is that this provides us a systematic approach to express the achievable rate region and the Pareto frontier of this achievable rate region. So please follow me for this small exercise. The links are the consumers. The goods are the rate splitting parameters, where we define that the good of user 1 is his own rate splitting parameter, and the good of user 1, the second good of user 1, is 1 minus the rate splitting parameter of the second user. By this choice, we make sure that increasing the goods means we increase our data rate, because I will show you the result in a minute. So the utility function is the achievable rate user 1, given by the amount of goods he has for his own and the other user's rate splitting parameter. The special cases comprise single user decoding, treating interference as noise, point-to-point communication, and multi-user decoding. So depending on the rate splitting parameters, we can have different known operating cases. Now, the properties of the utility function are as follows. This utility function for rate splitting is first strongly increasing in the amount of goods that the user possess, and furthermore, it is quasi-concave in the amount of goods. In the proof of this proposition, we compute the indifference curves. These are the curves where the user has a constant utility, and we have different amounts of goods where this user can get the same utility. So this is denoted by the blue region for link 2 and the green region for link 1. And this illustration is called the Edgeworth box. The interesting point is that when we compute here, when we show this theorem, that it turns out that we compute also the tangent points of these indifference curves, and these tangent points correspond to the Pareto optimal points of the achievable rate region. So by taking this detour, we approach the problem from a different side, and we can compute the achievable rate region and the Pareto boundary of the rate region by looking at the tangent points of the indifferent curves. So in this example, we have found one such point, and that corresponds to the black box on the right-hand side, which is a Pareto point on the boundary of the achievable rate region. So there is a way to do this computation, and it is quite efficient. But we can even go one step beyond and ask, can we do this in a distributed fashion? Can we find a Pareto optimal point in a distributed fashion? And in order to make this additional step, we have to include something which is called the market equilibrium. So we have to introduce prices that users pay for the goods, in this case for the rate splitting parameters, and we have to give them some budget. And when we do this clever, then we have budget for user one. This is basically all the goods he can buy for the prices Q1 for good one, Q2 is the price for good two. And he has a total budget of one. And so we have identified the two links with the consumers who buy goods with their budget. Each user buys as much good as it can maximize its utility. So we have a utility maximization problem, which is formulated over here, over the rate splitting parameters. The demand is the vector that corresponds to the amount of good that user one would like to buy in terms of good one and good two. Now, the Walras equilibrium is one market outcome. It describes the potential outcome of this competitive market model, and it has a very simple idea. It chooses the prices such that the market clears. And that means that you buy, that both users in this case buy all the goods that are available. And in order to express this market equilibrium, the excess demand is computed, which is the demand of user one for good one plus the demand of user two for good one minus the total amount of good one. So it's, as the name says, it's the excess in demand compared to the supply. And the same for the second good. Now we collect all the excess demand functions in one vector. And then we say we are looking for a price vector such that the excess demand is exactly equal to zero. That's the point where the market clears and the consumers want to have the goods according to their demand, and all supply is distributed to the two users. And in our case, we can compute first that the Walras equilibrium exists, because we can show that our utility functions are continuous, strongly increasing and strictly quasi-concave. This is what we have shown in the first proposition. And second, we have to find an initial possess of each user. And in our model, we just say that user one possesses all rate splitting parameters, so lambda 1 is equal to 1, and for the user 2, he gets all of his rate splitting parameters, lambda 2 is equal to 1. The uniqueness of the Walras equilibrium can be answered by checking the gross substitute property. That's a property that you can find in microeconomics theory. It's, I guess, the students learn this in microeconomics in the undergraduate courses. But we can easily check that our excess demand functions satisfy this requirement. And the last property of the Walras equilibrium is that it is Pareto optimal. So we have found a solution to our rate splitting parameter optimization, which gives us a point on the Pareto boundary of our utility region. And the final step now is to find a distributed algorithm, and there exists something that is called Walras-Tatonement process. And there is a discrete update variant according to that, where you update the price vector according to the excess demands with a certain step size. But there are ways to choose the step size such that the algorithm is globally convergent if the gross substitution property is satisfied. And we apply this algorithm to compute an optimal operating point for the rate splitting achievable rate region, which is at the Pareto boundary. This distributed implementation takes only two iterations to converge and to find this point. So by this, we have partly answered how can we approach the Pareto optimal points of the achievable rate region with rate splitting. I will skip that and go to the challenges that are required to establish rate splitting as one enabling technology for beyond 5G and 6G. So we have this challenge of the sum of rate expressions that pop up. So we have to deal with that to build a simple and efficient interface between the physical layer and the system level. And if you look at the history and the publications that were written about this system level interface at the medium access control layer, where you see all the papers about power control for different system setups, it's really important to bring this technology to the higher layers and make it applicable. So we need some SINR-based interface that would be best, but it might be difficult to achieve. However, it was also possible for Massive MIMO by coming up with some interesting expressions for the achievable rates there. And we have also to take into account what does it mean if our transceivers apply rate splitting at the encoder and at the decoder when it comes to the functional splits in future RAN systems. You know that there are many different options discussed right now, and the relationship between the physical layer techniques and the medium access control layer has a tremendous impact on this functional split. What we will see in this webinar series that comes up, there are many, many works on the combination of rate splitting with novel technologies. But there are also some missing. I'm not sure, but I have not seen rate splitting with cell-free massive MIMO yet, rate splitting in grant-free random access for massive machine type communication, rate splitting in finite block length coding. That might be also necessary to move on. So I think the potentials of rate splitting are tremendous, and the integration into the complete radio access network requires some further work, but we have 10 years until we have 6G, and I'm pretty sure that we can achieve these steps to make it feasible. So that concludes the talk. Here are some more general references to our work that we did in resource allocation and optimal power control. And please feel free to visit the webpage. Thank you very much for your attention, and I would like to answer your questions.
Thank you very much, Edward, for this very excellent talk. I really enjoyed it. Lina, would you like to take the lead on the Q&A sessions, or?
Sure. So if anyone has any questions, you can raise your hands or you can directly unmute yourself to ask questions to Edward directly.
While we are waiting, I can ask already one question. Edward, I was wondering in your view, so obviously we understand that rate splitting originated really in the interference channel. Do you think this is the scenario where actually rate splitting will see the biggest benefit or the most practical application, or do you envision this in some other type of scenario, other type of channels, or whatever way you can call it?
Yeah, I think it's a good question. I mean, let's take a look at the first slide. This interference channel where the rate splitting was invented is a system model which can also occur in system setups which are not originally a interference channel. For example, I want to make an example of what I mean. So let's consider you are looking at a broadcast channel with multiple antennas maybe, and you perform some linear precoding in terms of beamforming. And you keep your beamformers fixed for the two receivers. Then what you basically do is you have two data streams for your two users. You have fixed your beamformers and you get some effective channels in terms of the direct links, which is the beamforming vector times the direct channel. and the interfering links, which is the beamforming vector intended for user one, which travels over the channel to user two. So you basically end up in an interference channel setup if you limit yourself to linear beamforming. And then, of course, you can apply the same techniques that are presented here. There's one difference, though, and of course, I don't need to explain this to you, because in this case, you have one common encoder. So the encoder sits at one place because you basically look at the broadcast channel. And what you can do is you can basically combine the common messages as you have done in your works. So this will simplify the situation in terms of the decoding of the common messages and finding a suitable precoder for the common messages. But in the end, the boundary between the interference channel and the broadcast channel with linear precoding is, from my point of view, is not very strict. Yeah, so the techniques that are developed for the interference channel can be applied in other setups where we end up in an effective interference channel as well. Okay, and when it comes now to applications, so I listed some of the topics which are currently discussed in 6G, fundamental research. So if you look for on cell-free massive MIMO, so such a situation could happen with these. So you have a central controller, you have some central coding scheme, but you choose the beamformers across different remote radio heads with massive MIMO antennas. So I guess the setup could be relevant. In terms of finite block length coding, I think that the first results will be achieved for the interference channel there. Yeah, because we have already results for the multiple access channel with finite block length. So the second order or third order achievable rates, and I guess the interference channel will come next. Yeah, it's hard to predict.
Thank you, Edward.
Thank you, Edward, for your answer. So we also have a question from Rafael Lima. So his or her question is that, what's the benefit of array splitting in scenarios when interference can be mitigated by other methods, such as simple linear processing in massive MIMO?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's also a very good question. So I think that the combination of linear precoding, for example, in massive MIMO, and rate splitting is very interesting. So you can have different design objectives, actually. And I think that it can be well explained in the different operating regions for the interference channel. So let's say that you want to operate in a regime where the treating interference as noise is very, very strong. Then you would try to reduce the interference and get some interference channels which are very small, which have very small gains. That could be achieved by zero-forcing, massive MIMO zero-forcing precoding. That's perfectly fine. However, depending on the location of users, depending on their channels, it might cost you something in terms of power, in terms of degrees of freedom that you lose for the zero forcing. Depending on the scenario, this might be costly or not. It might be easier in scenarios where the users are well aligned, similar to the idea of NOMA clustering. You have two users which have already some channels which are highly correlated. So maybe it is easier to come to the regime where we have strong interference. Then we will choose the beamforming vectors to generate effective channels which align very well. And then we operate in a regime where we know the capacity and it is achieved by multi-user detection. That's another option. And of course, if we have rate splitting, then these two extreme cases are they get additional choices by treating the common message in the way that the effective channels for the common message should be aligned as well as possible, while the effective channels of the private messages should be orthogonal as possible. So in this case, we can directly combine the ideas from rate splitting with the beamforming.
Thank you, Edward, for your answer. So another question from Neil Baker is that how does rate splitting extend it to a large group of users?
Yeah, that's a very good question, and I should have also mentioned that, because as you can see here, for two users, we have in total three rate expressions per user. So if you have more users than two, then you can also decide on the decoding order of the receivers, right? So you will have a common message from each transmitter, including your own transmitter, and you would have a private message from your own transmitter. So you have multiple options to choose the decoding order. That's the first challenge. And the second challenge is that the number of inequalities grows. So the extension is possible. I mean, in this paper, in the original paper, it was, or if we go to this book, we can also stick to the book here. Here, this is, you can also see the general expression there, but the complexity will grow. In terms of decoding orders, the options will increase, and also in terms of the rate inequalities. And the argument that I brought here, that one inequality is automatically fulfilled because we have a stronger user, is not that straightforward anymore. Then you need to check whether you can order the users and what are the corresponding optimal decoding orders. And you know, working with decoding orders is not so simple, because the decoding order can also depend on external effects like interference that is created from other systems. And then this will change your optimal decoding order. So I would say that the multi-user extension provides further challenges that we have to work on.
Thank you, Edward. Indeed, so for applying rate splitting in the multi-user interference channel, that might be a lot of research works that we can do here. All right, so there's another question from Mokhtar Bello. So her question is that, does the rate splitting outperform Norma in uplink also, or it's just for the downlink?
Okay, so in the uplink case, in the multiple access channel, we know the capacity region, and it is achieved by point-to-point codes with a multi-user decoder, namely successive interference cancellation. So in this case, the capacity region is already known, and you can call it NOMA if you want. It's non-orthogonal access because you let all the users transmit at the same time, and NOMA achieves the capacity. The idea here is, in this paper, was to apply the rate splitting for a system where you don't need the synchronization, first of all, and second, for a simple single user coding and decoding. This is, so you have also a single user decoder at the receiver side. So the rate splitting multiple access scheme here was not to increase the rate region, because the capacity region is already available, but to make it easier to achieve.
Okay, so thank you, Edward, for this great talk. Well, we have another question. So this is the last question that Edward will going to ask, okay? Mm-hmm. So the question is that, would you please a little bit explain about the application of rate splitting in IRS or RIS? I mean, rate splitting would be, can rate splitting be helpful for IRS or RIS?
Yeah, I think the other way around. So the reconfigurable intelligent surfaces might be helpful to bring the system to an operating point where rate splitting can be beneficial. So indeed, what I said about the beamforming that you apply at the transmitter side can be also said about the phases or the amplitudes, if it's possible, at the RIS to control the effective channels and to bring them into a way or into a to a representation that is good for applying one of these decoding schemes. So that should mean that by the phases, by the phase shifts at the RIS, you can control the effective channels, and then if the effective channels bring you in some of these operating regions, you can then easily decode, and you know that you can achieve the capacity. It's an ongoing work that we have also in this area, so I think it might be worthwhile to look at how much can rate splitting then increase the data rate if we have already an optimized RIS. So I think, yes, can be combined, and we are working on it.
Yeah, thank you, Edward. Yeah, indeed, there are already some recent works that work on rate splitting and IRS. So Atta, if you are interested, you can contact me. I'm happy to share all those references with you. Okay, so this is the end of this webinar. Thank you a lot, so much, Edward, for your kind support to this webinar. And Bruno?
Thank you, Edward, for the great talk. Really liked it.